Lisa. Good morning, and welcome to Main Street United Methodist Church, to those here in the sanctuary and those who are watching online. Announcements this morning. As always, there are many prayer concerns, so please keep these people in your thoughts and prayers throughout the week. Birthdays, Max Higgins' birthday is the 23rd, Ty Calloway's is the 26th, and Seth Smith's is the 27th. There are no anniversaries. The greeting cards in the narthex today are for Pat Leslie, Steve Richmond, and Pauline Pruitt. Tuesday, the 23rd, the United Methodist Men will be making ham loaves in the morning, and if you are interested in purchasing some, there is a sign-up sheet outside of the office. They have one-pounders and two-pounds. And as most of you are aware, this coming week is our rummage sale. And they would like some help after worship today just to finish setting up the tables. There are many already set up, left over from noodle making, but there are more that need to be. And also, in the morning, you need help bringing up things, is that correct? Next Sunday, Pastor Julia will not be with us, but David Henry will be preaching. She will be at General Conference. And also on this coming Friday, there'll be no Bible study because of the rummage sale. And a thank you to all who came and helped with noodle making this past Monday. We've sold all that we made, but we will be making noodles again in May. So if you want noodles, please let Marcia know. Just let the office know that how many you need, and we'll get you on the list. Worship leaders are needed for the rest of the year, starting in June. So if that's something you're interested in, you could do it, I'm sure. And we have a new ice maker, and we want to thank Joe Pullen and Bill Conaway for putting that together. I don't see anything else here. The Finance Committee met this past week, and I guess I was elected this time to give you a little financial update. I would like each of you to look at your bulletin, the front of your bulletin. Main Street's mission statement is on the front, and I'd like for us to say it together. Love God, share faith, make Christ-like disciples. Short and simple. When we are planning mission activities or any programs, we should always keep this statement at the forefront. And if then you turn your bulletin over, we see at the end of March our deficit in the operating fund was $30,400. The operating fund is made up of our regular pledges and contributions. We have another account that is operating reserve, which is made up of various donations other than pledges. For instance, we receive a quarterly check from an estate, and we have for many years. And that amount varies, of course, with the stock market. We currently are receiving a monthly check from the conference in the amount of $2,083, and that is assisting us with some of our expenses until KUO comes on board. Special gifts sometimes are put into that operating reserve account. Earlier this year, a member gave a gift of $5,000, which was over and above their pledge. So that money went into the operating reserve account. Special offerings, such as the love offering that we took up a couple of years ago, also goes in there. And that's just a sampling of some of the monies that go into the reserve account. The balance on the education building roof loan is approximately $17,000. That was at the end of March. We have since, in April, made a $1,000 payment, so that reduces that somewhat. And if you recall, that loan opened in 2021. We borrowed $55,000. And when the agreement is signed with KUO, then that balance will be paid, and that money will come from the capital fund account. We've done very well paying that loan and getting it down. Our giving may be down, but we are trying to hold our expenses down too. Recently, Dallas Calloway, our mission chairperson, and Pastor Julia applied for a grant from the conference in the amount of $6,000. This will be used to help underwrite expenses for our food pantry and God's Closet. Pardon?
We applied for the grant,
yes,
but we do not know if we have been granted that.
Yes, that was what I was going to say. They have applied for it. Please pray that we will be awarded it. We do not know when our actions will impact others. Recently, a couple visited our Sunday morning service, and talking with them, we learned that they were married here 41 years ago and were in town taking care of some family business and decided to stop by and visit our worship service. Also, several weeks ago, I stopped at a restaurant to pick up lunch for Chuck and I. And while I was waiting on my order, a lady was leaving and she was pushing another woman in a wheelchair. And I offered to get up to help her with the door, and as she was leaving, she said to me, "I enjoy watching your choir sing on Sunday mornings." And I was slightly taken aback because I have no idea who the lady was, and I think I stuttered something like, "You watch us?" And I thanked her as she shut the door, but I was just so pleasantly surprised. Like I said, I have no idea who it was. There are many stories that we could share about how our church has helped our families, our friends, and our community. And remember, love God, share faith, make Christ-like disciples. Thank you. I think it's time to pass the peace this morning. God be with you. Please share the peace of God.
Indeed, how great is the love of our Lord, who is with us always as we come together for worship. May we always remember God's greatness, God's love, and God's grace. Would you please join me in our opening prayer? Holy God, great is your love and faithfulness. From the beginning, you have been the good shepherd, leading us to calm waters and grassy land. You protect us and seek us out when we go astray. Lord, for all that you do, and for all that those like you do in caring for others, thank you. May we seek to be more like you in all of our thoughts, words, and deeds. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Would you please be seated as we continue in our time of worship together with a reading from the New Testament.
The New Testament reading is from 1 John 3, 16 through 24. This is how we know love. Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. But if someone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but refuses to help, how can the love of God dwell in a person like that? Little children, let's not love with words or speech, but with action and truth. This is how we will know that we belong to the truth and reassure our hearts in God's presence. Even if our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our hearts and knows all things. Dear friends, if our hearts don't condemn us, we have confidence in relationship to God. We receive whatever we ask from him because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. This is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love each other as he commanded us. Those who keep his commandments dwell in God, and God dwells in them. This is how we know that he dwells in us, because of the Spirit he has given us. Holy words, holy wisdom. Our reflection song is Because He Lives, 364 in your hymnal.
Amen. As we come now to a time of prayer, I would invite you to remember the delegates who will be traveling to General Conference in the next day or so. As a reminder, General Conference typically only happens once every 4 years, and this is one occurring will cover the 2020 conference that was supposed to take place. So these delegates have been working towards this moment for a long time. They have 2 weeks to be present with one another and discuss the legislature and the laws of the church. And that's a lot of work to be done. And it's not just delegates from Indiana, although we have our own contingency, but it's also people from all over the world. Because we are a united church, we are a global church. And let's be praying for those, whether they are traveling just down the street to Charlotte or they're coming and crossing oceans. But let us remember to be praying for them and for the work that they do, even as we pray for our brothers and sisters here in the church and the various struggles we all face. I invite you now to a time of prayer where I will lead us in prayer, and then there will be a time of silence before we conclude together with the Lord's Prayer. But let us go to the Lord. Holy and gracious God, great is your mercy, your goodness, and your love. You call us to service. You call us to life. And Lord, we find joy in life, but sometimes we're stubborn. Sometimes we want things to go our way and not your way. Sometimes, Lord, our love is limited. But what peace and joy, what a reassurance it is to know that your love knows no limit. That it is there covering us even in our mistakes, in our sins, in our faults. Lord, may your Spirit be with us, be with our United Methodist brothers and sisters and siblings as we seek to grow as a church and consider the way that you are leading us and the way that we can be more like you, the way that we can be more loving. Lord, we offer our prayers to you through song and silence and through remembering that we are your children, one church, one body. And so it is we pray together the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Would our choir please come forward? Thank you. choir for that beautiful gift of music. As we continue in our worship, we come now to the time of the gospel lesson. And this morning's gospel lesson, it's taking place as part of a grander story. For some context, prior to John 10, there is naturally John chapter 9. And it is in chapter 9 that Jesus has his disciples ask him a question, because they see a man who was born blind from birth. And they say, well, Lord, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus answers, neither. Rather, this is not for sin, but to glorify God. And he healed the man, and the man was just in awe. He was excited. He was full of wonder. And the rest of the people were as well, because, oh my gosh, what a joy, what a miracle. Except there's always someone who has to bring down the party. And for, well, Jesus had healed the man on the Sabbath, and when the Pharisees found out that he had done work on the Sabbath, they were furious. They even went so far as declaring, well, there must be a demon of some sort in him, since he worked on the Sabbath, since he healed on the Sabbath. You know that if Jesus hadn't done the healing on the Sabbath, they would have found something else to gripe at him about. But Jesus meets their questions, meets their conflict, and he speaks with them. And he speaks to the Pharisees, offering lessons that they are not ready to hear, but that they need to hear nevertheless. A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. When the hired hand sees the wolf coming, he leaves the sheep and runs away. That's because he isn't the shepherd. The sheep aren't really his. So the wolf attacks the sheep and scatters them. He's only a hired sheep, only a hired hand, and the sheep don't matter to him. I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, I give up my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that don't belong to this sheep pen, and I must lead them too. They will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock with one shepherd. This is part of why the Father loves me. I give up my life so that I can take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I give it up because I want to. I have the right to give it up, and I have the right to take it up again. I received this commandment from my Father. This is the gospel of the risen Christ. Thanks be to God. Would you please pray with me? Holy Lord, may we be ready to hear the words of your Spirit. May we be ready to hear familiar words, to hear a familiar text, and be ready to hear it in new ways, that we may be renewed in the Spirit, in your Spirit, and that we may better recognize the Good Shepherd when he walks among us. In the name of your Son we pray. Amen. So I've mentioned a few times before, I have this college roommate who I'm lucky enough that I still am able to see her. We still get together at times, and she is a mom. She's a new mom, which does mean that we aren't able to get together as much as we used to. I mean, when you've got a little one that is just starting to walk and run and talk, you only have so much energy in the day. But, you know, even though I am not related to this child at all, of course I am Aunt Julia, because sometimes family goes beyond blood or goes beyond the binds of marriage or legal adoption. Sometimes family is the people that you choose, the people who matter to you that you bring into your life. In many ways, similar to how we are as a church. But I remember when I first started talking to her, it's like, I'm so excited for you, and you are going to do a great job. As a mom, I am going to just build you up. I'm going to hype you up. You can do this. This is a terrifying thing that you are undertaking, because that is a whole human being. But you've got this. But in the midst of the hype, of the encouragement, I also had a moment of asking, okay, look, are you really doing okay with this? Because this is a big task. It's a lot of pressure raising a kid. Are you okay? Like, do you know that, I mean, you're going to be an amazing mom, but do you know that you're going to make mistakes? Do you know that you're going to mess up? Are you prepared for how to deal with that? And her response to me was, oh, believe me, I know I will mess up. I'm going to do my best to be a good mom, but I know I'm going to make mistakes. But here's the thing. I'm going to do my best to teach my daughter good communication skills so that she is able to voice what she needs. She's able to say when she is afraid or hurt or upset. She's able to recognize and speak the words. And I'm also going to raise her in such a way that she trusts me, that I'm worthy of her trust, so that when I make a mistake, when I mess up, when I do something that I realize later is going to land her in therapy in 20 years, I want to make sure that she has the ability to say the words, to verbalize the hurt, and the confidence to know that I will listen, that I will hear her. It's not easy to be a caregiver. Whether you are a parent or an aunt or uncle, maybe you've been a caregiver by looking after your siblings or cousins. Maybe when you were younger, you babysat the neighborhood kids, keeping an eye on everyone. Maybe you remember helping your grandparents. Or maybe you remember caring for your parents. Maybe you remember you've been caring for a spouse. And you do it out of love. No questions asked. To be a caregiver requires an immense amount of love and patience. But it's not easy. It is very much not easy work. And sometimes it can be really tempting to consider the ways that we care for others and to see the ways we fall short and think, I'm failing at everything. I'm not good enough. I can't do everything. Or, God, I am just so tired. I am so frustrated. I still love this person. I'm willing to do this. But this is so much. This is so much. And those are the words you can't post on Facebook, that you can't always say out loud in church. We can't always talk about the parts of being a caregiver that can drain us. Or we don't like to think about those parts because we know that others are caring for us. But it's part of life. It's a truth for all of us that there are struggles, there are stress. There are times where we are at our best and times where we are just getting by. And in reflecting on the different types of caregivers, in preparing the sermon, there was something that caught my eye in the gospel lesson. It was how Jesus described both himself as the good shepherd and then the other shepherd, the hired hand. Now, there is a long tradition of referring to shepherds, to sheep, in the Bible. It is a very common connection that would be used of, if you are a good king, you're a good ruler, then you're a good shepherd. You are taking care of your people, your flock. You're making sure that they have food to eat, that they're not too stressed out, that there's water, that they're safe. But then on the other side of that, there are places in Scripture where prophets will call out the rulers who have not been loyal to God, who have not been taking care of their people. And there they are blatantly referred to as the bad shepherd. In Jeremiah 23, verses 1 through 3, there's this promise of restoration that Jeremiah makes to the people, but he also offers a warning saying, "Watch out, you shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture," declares the Lord. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, proclaims about the shepherds who tend to my people. "You are the ones who have scattered my flock and driven them away. You haven't attended to their needs, so I will take revenge on you for the terrible things you have done to them," declares the Lord. "While I myself will gather the few remaining sheep from all the countries where I have driven them, I will bring them back to their pasture, and they will be fruitful and multiply. They will be safe from the bad shepherd." But Jesus doesn't say that the hired hand is a bad shepherd. And I think we do a disservice to the hired hand in his story when we declare, "Oh, he must be a bad shepherd. She must be a terrible shepherd," because, I mean, they're not protecting the sheep. They're not doing their job. Well, for one thing, Jesus points out that they are not the shepherd. They are a hired hand. They do not own the sheep. They are there because they have been hired to work, hired to help. And there is nothing wrong with valuing their life and not wanting to be killed by a wolf or a bear or lion or whatever might be attacking the sheep. Does it mean bad news for the sheep? Absolutely. But just because the shepherd wants to live, just because the hired hand wants to live, that doesn't make them bad. If anything, that just makes them human. Because while we can care for our loved ones, care for our friends when they are sick, care for our families, sometimes we have trouble caring for the people around us, or the people in the next town over, the people who live on the other side of town even, because we don't know them. We're not a part of their lives. They're not a part of us. They're just someone else. And we can care about them in a general sense, but there is also research to suggest that we struggle with caring. Social scientists have been looking into the phenomenon of the bystander effect since 1964 in relation to the case of Kitty Genovese, where this young woman was in her home, and a window was open. It was along a busy street, and someone broke into her home and attacked her. And she called for help. They realized after the fact that she had been calling for help to her neighbors, to anyone passing by, and no one stopped. They heard a woman screaming for help, and nobody stopped. And there's been other research done since then because, wait a minute, this doesn't make sense. This doesn't seem right. What is going on? And we find the bystander effect. We find this discomfort that we may have where we might observe a thing. We'll witness. You know, we'll watch a fight or we'll film a fight, but stepping in to stop the fight? Oh, no. Or we may... To kind of bring the intensity down a little bit. We may be walking along the street and we notice a bit of litter, you know, in the street, some trash. And we think, well, someone else will get it. Someone else will pick it up. I don't need to take care of this. Someone else will. And it's not done from a place of malice. Honestly, I think some of it's just done from a place of, surely there's someone better than me who can take care of this task. I'm not brave enough, or I'm not good enough, or maybe even, well, I don't understand the full situation. Maybe there isn't anything wrong. Maybe I'm just being a nosy busybody if I interrupt. You know, maybe they're acting in a play. Maybe there's this. Maybe there's that. It's like, you know, I don't know the situation. And I also have these places I need to get to. I'm on a schedule. So, you know, someone else. Someone else will come by. Someone else will take care of it. But you contrast that to the Good Shepherd, to Jesus, who is saying that I will lead them to peaceful waters, to grassy hills, to pastures where they may rest, where I am willing to stand in front of them, to stand between them and the wolf, to keep them safe. But it's an even greater contrast, because Jesus in this scripture, he is not talking about saving the sheep in the manner of David did when he was protecting his father's flocks, when he was still a child before he had faced Goliath or had been crowned king. When David was a child, he would watch the flocks, and with a sling and some stones, he would protect the sheep from lion, from bears, from wolves, from anything that tried to threaten the sheep. He would fight and he would defend them. But it's interesting that Jesus doesn't say here that he will fight, that he will defeat everything. Rather, he says, I will lay down my life. I will lay down my life for the sake of the sheep. And you might think, well, what good does that do? If you lay down your life, then who's going to protect the sheep once you're gone? Well, for one thing, it's Jesus, and the story never stops there. Because it's not just a simple, I will lay my life down for them. It is also, I will take my life up for them. I will come back. I will love them in a way that they have never been loved before, that they could never understand or ever hope to fully emulate. Because, see, we can try to be Christ-like. We are Christians, we are followers of Christ, we seek to be Christ-like, but there are just some things that Christ can do that we can't. And that's okay. It's okay to take time and recognize that, you know what? I need God's grace. Because I can't do everything on my own. I can't fix every problem. I can't take care of every sick person. I can't raise every child or protect every sheep. I can't do it all. None of us can. None of us can. But there's the relief in knowing that we don't have to. In 1 John chapter 3, Marge read for us earlier about how the Lord knows our hearts. The Lord knows our hearts. If we seek to love and to be good, to seek to follow in the ways of God, to look at what we have and consider how we can help those who are in need, even if we mess up, even if our hearts are filled with contempt, if we're making errors, even then, God still knows our hearts and knows that we're trying. That we're trying to be like God, that we're trying to be like Jesus, that we are doing our best to follow the Holy Spirit. And sometimes we need to give ourselves grace that is enough. That it's okay if we make a mistake, that maybe we pick up a piece of trash that was actually supposed to stay there, or, you know, we interrupt a fight or a disagreement, we interrupt something because something seems wrong here, and then you find out, oh, you didn't need to. Well, guess what? Sometimes you have to try. Sometimes you just have to try. You may not be the perfect parent, the perfect child, the perfect caregiver. But there's a lot we can do when we show up. And there's a lot of room for love, for a willingness to try, when we remember we don't have to do everything perfectly. Rather, we need to rely on the grace and love of God. And that can be hard. It can be hard to truly believe that God could love the people in our lives as much as we love them. In the book of Matthew, chapter 7, verses 9 through 11, Jesus has been speaking with his disciples about it's part of the Sermon on the Mount, so it's been covering a lot. He's been going through a lot of things. And he's talking about how ask and you will receive, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you, and how we do these things. We are willing to knock and to seek, to try. We're willing to try and to go and do, because who among you will give your children a stone when they ask for bread? Or give them a snake when they ask for fish? If you who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good things to those who ask him? We try our best, and we do our best. And sometimes our best doesn't feel like it's enough. But when we act out of love, there is someone greater at work. There is someone greater whose love covers all of us, all of our faults, and all of our successes. And we know we can trust him because he is willing to lay down his life for us, even to the point of betrayal, of denial, of death on a cross and being placed in a tomb, only for the stone to roll away and for him to take up his life again. Would you please pray with me? Holy and gracious God, you, your Son, your Holy Spirit, they are filled with grace. You showed grace to the disciples, to the Pharisees. You show grace to us. Because, Lord, we try our best. But we also know that sometimes, even when we try, even when we do, we're still going to fall short of you. But what a relief it is to know that your love does not depend upon us meeting some impossible height. Rather, your love simply is, and we are called to take part in it, to be your sheep, for you are the good shepherd. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. We come now in our worship to a time of offering, again, where we're doing our best. We do the best we can as a church, as a community, to care for one another, to support the missions, to support the work of the church. So as our ushers come forward, please, just do your best. Whatever you are able to give to God today, that's more than enough. Will our ushers please come forward?
Thank you.
Almighty God, take these gifts and may they be blessed for your purpose. Take them, Lord, and may they be put to use for your kingdom, that we would see your will be done, that your love would shine as a beacon for all to witness, and that all would know the Good Shepherd. Lord, it is in the name of your Son that we pray. Amen. I would invite you to remain standing as we move to our closing song, remembering again that God's grace is more than enough to cover all of us. That even when we're feeling weak, God is still going strong. So let us sing together this truth that God's grace is enough.
Thank you.
Indeed, indeed, our Lord's grace is enough for us. Our Lord uses the weak to lead the strong, the foolish to confound the wise. The Lord uses whatever we have to offer to create something wonderful, to create something good. So whatever you have to give, whatever you have to offer this week, give it with love. Give it with love for your neighbor, for your family, for your friend, for the stranger on the street. And know always that God is with you wherever you go. May you go in peace. Amen.